Hello, I'm Graham and I hope everyone's having a great day. Welcome to today's video review of the Aperlite YH-500C TTL compatible flash gun for Canon cameras. Now the YH-500C sits midway between the entry level 400 and the flagship model 700C. The 400 is only a slave and manual only operation, where the 700C is both master and slave compatible and all the ETTL compatibility of the Canon 580 EX2 model. This sits midway and is a TTL compatible unit with slave and multi-strobe operation facilities. In the box you'll get the flash unit, the foot which has a metal insert so it won't strip when you attach it to a light stand or a tripod, an instruction manual and a nylon carry pouch. Let's look at the flash in a little bit more detail. The flash unit itself, being ETTL compatible, does have a metal hot shoe which carries all the pins for the communication between the camera and the hot shoe for the ETTL compatible communication link. It has a friction lock on the hot shoe, unlike the Canon which has the quick release kit. It's powered by four AA batteries, and they sit in the compartment on the right hand side of the flash unit, and you can either use alkaline or nickel metal hydride dependent on your preference. The unit itself can be powered externally by a flash unit, but unfortunately this is a Nikon Speedlight compatible power socket. Even though this is designated for a Canon compatible camera, the actual power charging socket is for the Nikon Speedlight range. So be aware, if you have the facility to use an external Canon charging circuit, it will not fit this flash unit. On the side of the unit we see a coaxial socket, which is the Pronto Compo range, and that is the 1/8 inch coaxial cable link between this and a remote trigger. The optical trigger is picked up by the receiver on the right hand side of the front of the unit. It doesn't sit within the red perspex of the flash unit. The head of the flash unit will rotate a full 270 degrees, and that incorporates 90 degrees to the right and a full 180 degrees to the left. In addition to the rotation, you can actually, in addition to the horizontal rotation, the head will lift vertically from minus 7 degrees down, so it allows you to use the flash at a closer working distance, to the horizontal position, or 0 degrees, up through 45 degrees, 60 degrees, 75 degrees, and vertically at 90 degrees. None of the detent positions are locked. It's unlike the Canon unit, which you'd have to depress the two side buttons to release the head. This is all done by friction lock. The head supports a pull-down wide-angle panel diffuser, and it also incorporates a white catchlight flag. So if you're using this in the bounce flash mode, if you leave the flag out and use the head at 60 degrees and have the flash at a distance of 5 feet to your subject, the flash will illuminate the catchlight panel and that will be picked up in the eyes of your subject and provide that nice highlight or catchlight in the eye. Store it away, lift the two panels and close them both down together. When you power on this unit, it will revert to a default zoom of 50 mm. If you pull out the wide panel diffuser, the head will zoom back to 14 mm. This is a feature that only occurs on this particular model. It doesn't exist on the entry level 400 or indeed on the flagship 700. So the incorporation of this panel diffuser and the intelligence to move the head back to the start position is a worthwhile feature on this gun. There's still no indication if you've got the head down at the minus 7 degree position, and you sometimes can be taking pictures at a great distance and not realise that you've not got the head back to the horizontal position. When the unit is powered up, it reverts to the last mode of operation. If you've not been using the unit for a while, it goes into the hibernate mode, which is indicated by the SL or sleep on the panel. To wake it up from sleep mode, you need to press the pilot button. It will wake up from sleep when it's attached to a hot shoe and it gets the trigger command from either a remote trigger or from the camera hot shoe. To change the mode, we just need to press the mode button on the top left hand side of the unit, and that allows us to cycle through the operations from TTL, manual, multi-strobe, slave flash mode 1 and slave flash mode 2. If we consider the manual mode first, in the manual mode it allows us to set an individual power level anywhere from the minimum power setting of 1 over 128 up to the maximum power, which is 1 over 1. And to change the value, we use the up and down arrow keys of the four-way navigation button. In between each full increment, there are two steps of 0.3 increment for each step. And now we've reached full power. To change the zoom, if you're using this manually on a light stand or on a tripod, depressing the zoom button allows us to have access to the up and down keys again to change the zoom setting. If you're using this on a camera with ETTL control, the camera will set the zoom level. If I now move from the manual mode to the strobe mode by pressing the mode key, it takes us into the facility to check the power level, the number of flashes that will occur during this exposure sequence, and the interval that the flashes will occur. You can change the power level between a quarter and 1/128th, and you notice that we're using whole increments. There are no 0.03 increment between each stage. The number of pulses and the interval between them will be determined by the power level. Generally speaking, the lower the power, the more you can set the number of flashes or the interval between them. If I press the set key, it takes me into the facility to change the interval between the flash pulses. So with a 1 Hz frequency, the pulses will occur at 1 second intervals. If I change this to 2, so if you divide 1 by 2, you'll get the interval, which is a half a second. If I change this to 4, if you divide that into 1, you'll find that the pulses are 0.25 seconds interval between each pulse. So you can use the Hertz to determine the interval between each flash pulse. If I use the left arrow key, it gives me the facility to change now the number of pulses that will occur during this cycle. Notice that at 1 quarter, the maximum number of pulses I can set is 2 with this interval. If I reduce the power, and to do that I need to cancel out of this mode by pressing the set key, if I reduce the power using the cursor down keys to a 32 and go back into the routine to set the frequency and the number of pulses, you now notice that I can change the number of pulses up to a maximum of 18 with this frequency. If I change the interval between the pulses to a lower number, so it gives the flash more time to charge up and the tube more time to cool down, then I can increase the number of flashes during this cycle. One more push of the mode button takes us into the slave flash mode, and here we have the S1 slave flash mode, which means the flash will fire synchronously with the first pulse of light it sees from the master flash. If you're using TTL, which uses a pre-flash mode, then you need to use the S2 function of this unit. So with S2, the flash will fire synchronously with the main flash of the unit. Let's now mount this flash unit on a camera and look at setting up the menus from Canon's in-camera menu setup system. I'll turn off the flash unit while I install it on the camera, and then we can proceed. I've set the flash up on this Canon EOS M so you can actually see the speed light control menu. If I go into the menuing system on the Canon camera and we cursor down to external speed light control, when I press the set button, it takes me into the options so I can communicate between the camera and the flash unit. So if I cursor down to flash functions, press set to enter that menu, you can see that I've got the choice between ETTL, the master flash on or off, the option to set zoom, first or second curtain synchronization, flash exposure compensation, and flash exposure bracketing. Now you can change the mode of the flash unit from this menu, so I can select manual, and if I press the set button, you notice that the flash unit has now changed to the manual mode. If I go to strobe mode, again the flash changes to strobe. If I go to ETTL mode, it gives me the option to set the first or second curtain synchronization. By default, we always fire in first synchronization mode, but you can set the camera to fire at the end of the exposure using the second curtain synchronization. So if I set that now, you notice now we've got the second curtain synchronization icon on the flash screen. If I try to set the flash master mode by turning the wireless on, when I press the set button, the menu comes back and says, no, you can't do that, it leaves it set to off. And it's the same with the zoom. The flash unit will support auto zoom, but it doesn't allow you to preset a zoom from within the camera. So if I wanted to set a 50mm zoom on this camera now, I would normally go into the menu, set 50mm and press the set button, and that would force the flash to drive to 50mm. It relies on the fact that the camera can pass the zoom information from the camera to the flash unit. And you notice if I change the zoom of the camera, the flash is responding by changing the position of the zoom head. Flash exposure compensation we can change, we can make it lighter or darker depending on what our initial exposure has been. And if I press the set, it doesn't give me any indication on the 500C that there is any exposure compensation set. But it does work, it does give you exposure compensation. Conversely, if I was to set the flash exposure compensation on the flash unit itself by using the additional power control, I can change the flash exposure compensation by -1. Now if I go back into this menu, you notice that it's told me I've got -1 set and it's greyed out, so the flash always overrides the camera. So notice when I've cancelled the flash exposure compensation, the camera now has control of the flash unit. Flash exposure bracketing doesn't work. If I try to put on flash exposure bracketing of 2 stops for each of the 3 exposures, when I press the set button, the camera reverts back to the 0, indicating that it hasn't managed to set the function within the speed light. If we were to set the strobe function again, we can set the number of pulses and the interval between them and the power level from within the Canon setup menu. Because the gun has all the TTL compatible pins, then if you use an extension cable, you can get the gun off camera to get some better modelling, or you could actually use this with a radio frequency trigger rather than the inbuilt optical trigger if you're having problems triggering this unit outdoors in bright sunshine. The unit is very well constructed, no gaps in the seams, the battery compartment closes nicely, got the metal foot, and the head rotation, both horizontally and vertical, the locks are sufficient to stop them being knocked accidentally. The only disappointment on this flash unit was in fact that it's supposed to be a Canon compatible unit, but it has the Nikon Speedlight power source, which means that you can't use it with a Canon compatible unit which has the Canon pin on the cable. Apart from that, the unit worked extremely well. The TTL works fine and the S1 and S2 mods work fine with the unit. So that's it for this video review of the YH-500C flash unit from Aperlite. There's a full review of this on my photographic blog site, and I'll put a link to that in the video description below. So, if you're a new viewer to the channel, please consider clicking the subscribe button. You'll be then notified if I upload any new tutorials or, in fact, product reviews to this channel. You'll be notified in your subscription list. So, until my next video, thanks again for watching. Please take care. And it's Graham saying goodbye for now.